Hello, I'm Hans Lee from LiveWire Markets, and welcome to the latest interview in our income series. Today, our guest is Pete Robinson, Head of Investment Strategy at Challenger Investment Management. And today, we're going to discuss the future for interest rates, the opportunities in fixed income, and the state of the property market. Pete, it's good to see you.
Nice to see you, Hans.
Let's start with interest rates. At least four research houses now believe we'll see a terminal cash rate of 4.35%, so that's one more than the recent RBA rate hike. CT erring towards 4.6, and Goldman's at about 4.85. Where do you sit on the debate?
Yeah, look, it's a really tough call. I think I'm relatively bearish in terms of the overall outlook. I think the cumulative impact of all the rate hikes that we've had are going to start to weigh on the household sector, but it's going to take time, and this is the quandary that the RBA is facing. We've built up cumulatively, you know, on bank balance sheets, you can see around $250 billion worth of excess deposits, above trend deposits, sitting with the bank. So households have a lot of money, and that's a big buffer as interest rates rise. So in an aggregate sense, it's going to take a while for that pressure to be felt. In the interim, what we've got is high levels of inflation, and starting to see that inflation pass through to the wages side above the RBA's target. And so I think you're going to have to see them go again and potentially multiple times.
How long is a while in this economy? I know normally, theoretically, it's about, 12 to 18 months, something like that. But in this economy, I expect it's probably a little bit different.
Yeah, look, it's a fascinating question and one we've been talking about internally as well. Like, if we look at the US, which is ahead of Australia and I think a good leading indicator in terms of their hiking cycle, they still have excess deposits residing in their system. So the Federal Reserve of San Francisco, they put out a piece of work in May talking about another $500 billion of excess savings still within the US, and that's from a peak of $2.1 trillion. So they're still there, even they're ahead of us, still lots of excess savings. So I think for them, there's a ways to go, maybe six to 12 months, and Australia's lagged even behind that. So still a ways to go before we see that excess liquidity flow out of the system.
All right. So if you're bearish, and you say that you've got a more bearish macro outlook, are you bearish in the sense that you're having to actively factor in the possibility of excessive rate hiking into your portfolio construction?
Yeah, absolutely. That's one big factor that we're thinking about at the moment. I think there's simply some sectors that cannot sustain a cash rate in the fives. There's just so much leverage that's been built up during the period of low interest rates that they can't cover their interest repayments when the cash rate goes to 5%. And that's not even factoring in, as default risk rises in the system, the fact that lenders will charge more for each dollar that they lend. So they're loading on extra credit spread on top of that higher interest rate. So think about the office sector where rents have barely moved. In the US, that's a sector under acute levels of focus. I think some of that focus is going to come here, because if the cash rate hits 5%, I think we're going to see interest coverage ratios below one. So that means that the actual rents coming off the assets themselves aren't enough to pay the interest. And so the question is, how do banks and non-bank lenders respond to that environment?
All right. We'll come back to the property situation a little later, but I know a lot of what you do, I think the bulk of what you do, is around fixed income, as I say, and has been telegraphed pretty much endlessly for the last year now. There was barely any income in fixed income for 15 years. Now that rates have risen this much, and there could be more to go yet, how long do you actually expect this Goldilocks period to last?
Well, it's interesting. I don't actually think it's a Goldilocks period right now, because inflation's so high. So inflation's eating into all of those returns. We've got CPI at 7%, a cash rate of 4%. So actually you're not having a very solid real return for your cash at the moment. So I think that search for yield that we had during 2021, 2022, that's still on, but it's a search for inflation-adjusted yield. So we're still searching for that yield after inflation.
Okay, so if you're saying now is not the Goldilocks period, are you saying the Goldilocks period is yet to come, and that will only come after inflation comes down?
Yeah, look, I think that the opportunities in fixed income are going to get better, particularly in that front end of the curve, as we see inflation normalise. The reality is the inflation has happened. It's already baked into the numbers, and that's backward looking. I think on a forward looking basis, if you're starting to get yields on cash at around 5%, you're getting mid to high single digit yields on credit, and more if you extend yourself into the high yield part of the market. That nets you a positive real return after inflation, even factoring in some elevated level of credit risk and market risk into your portfolio.
Yep. So in that market then, what would you say is the biggest opportunity You know, what is the biggest opportunity in today's market? And what is today's maybe most overbought or overhyped idea?
Yeah, I think the thing that I'm looking at really closely that I talked about before is the real estate sector. So we're currently quite underweight that and have been for some time. It was very aggressively priced and in some respects still remains quite aggressively priced. And really, I think that opportunity is going to emerge in the next 6 to 12 months as we start to see lenders having to recycle positions and they face those questions that I mentioned earlier of how do I deal with something where the interest coverage ratio is less than, let's say, 1.5 times where typically, you know, the banks are setting their covenants. How do I address that issue? And what we're going to see is I think a transition of lending out of the banking system into non-bank lenders. And so those non-bank lenders who have capacity to undertaking that lending are going to see some really attractive investment opportunities. The flip side of that, the overhyped idea, I think there's still parts of the private markets where valuations don't reflect reality. I think there's some venture capital backed fintech MBFIs that, you know, valuations I struggle to reconcile with. You know, they don't have a long-term sustainable path to profitability. Add to that, a lot of them put leverage at their holding company, so holdco debt, which was predicated on a much bigger balance sheet, which looks unlikely to occur. So I think there's parts of that market where, you know, some of these businesses aren't worth a whole lot, are still being carried at very elevated valuations.
Okay. Do a little bit of distinguishing if we can. Just the opportunities in corporate credit, and I guess within that, of course, there's investment grade versus high yield as well, but do a little bit of distinguishing if you can. The opportunities in corporate credit versus, say, government-issued bonds, which is, I think, what most people would be more familiar with. And then if you've got a preference for which one.
Yeah, so government debt, what we're really talking about here is a fixed rate of return without credit risk. So we're lending to a government. Governments can raise taxes in order to repay their debts. We had a, you know, interesting period last month with the Fed dealing with its debt ceiling issues. But ultimately, you know, you're backed by the full faith and credit of a government entity, which, you know, in the case of Australia or the United States is a pretty solid credit risk. So what you're really being compensated for is an outlook on where yields are heading. So you can lock in a return which historically has been above the cash rate. So if I lend a government money for 10 years, historically I would get a return above where cash is today. The yield curve would be upward sloping. And that was a return for me lending out money for longer. Now, as it stands today, that return is actually below the cash rate. So we've got an inverted yield curve. So I'm getting less by lending money for longer than I am for just sitting in cash today. That's because what typically happens when we have a shock or a recession is long-term interest rates decline on an expectation of lower growth. And so you have a capital appreciation in the government bonds. That's distinct from credit. And really, when I look at credit, I like to separate out the fixed rate component to it and think about the credit spread. And that credit spread is compensation for the risk of that borrower defaulting. So you'll get a spread on investment grade of around 100 basis points. Historically, default rates in investment grade credits are significantly below that. So you're getting an excess return for lending money to a company that may or may not pay you back. Right now, let's say in the high yield market, it's around 4%. Excess return over cash that you're getting paid. Expectations for defaults in that sort of 4 to 6% range, I think picking up from very low levels with recoveries of sort of 50%, you think, okay, I'm getting some sort of excess return for credit risk. So I think credit is fair valued. You know, it's not super cheap, it's not super expensive. I think the inverted yield curve makes it pretty difficult for me to get my head around investing in long-dated government debt at the moment.
Yep. All right. No, that's all fair enough. So we talked there a little bit about bonds. I know you pay attention very closely to the real estate market. We were talking earlier about commercial real estate, of course. And you were recently discussing the fixed rate mortgage cliff with us here at Livewire. Let me ask you this, though. Do you think investors are really prepared for the impact this roll-off will actually have on the wider economy?
Yeah, I think the psychology of markets is a fascinating thing. So when we see the same headline for 6 months, the first time we read that headline, we have a reaction to it. But after 6 months, that reaction really falls away. And I think that's really instructive for the way that the market is thinking about this fixed rate mortgage cliff. We've been reading about it for a long time and anticipating it for a long time, but actually the impact of it hasn't hit yet. So as we discussed recently, most of the resetting and most of the most impactful resetting, and by that I mean those mortgages that were fixed when rates were at their lowest, is yet to come. And it's actually starting right now. And the cumulative impact of that, as we see you know, a contraction in consumer spending, reduction in household savings rates, which we saw from the GDP data, that happens cumulatively over time. So it's not just that first month that the rate resets where you see the impact. It actually takes time. So yeah, I do think that markets have become, I guess, dulled to the news around the fixed rate mortgage cliff and are perhaps underestimating what the impact of that will be.
So we were talking about commercial values a little bit earlier, and you know how rents maybe in some parts of that particular space are not changing, so it makes valuations a little more difficult to get your head around. But in the residential market, I mean, rental incomes are likely to continue appreciating. And we've already seen a short little rally for house prices nationally, at least. How long do you think that will continue to be the case?
I think the housing market is really at the center of the quandary that's facing the RBA right now, because we have a two-speed market. We've got people that are on big mortgages, owner-occupiers who, you know, are earning an income but have high levels of mortgage debt, really struggling with these higher interest rates. Repayments that they have to make, and then we've got another part of the economy that has very low levels of debt that is not bothered. And in fact, if you think about a retiree, higher interest rates are actually benefiting them. So they're relatively insensitive to the level of interest rates. We've got the baby boomer generation transitioning into, you know, the later stages of retirement as well. And so some of those transactions that we've seen that's really fueled that housing market recovery have been predicated on, you know, downsizing, where you're effectively, you know, a price insensitive buyer. And that's, I think, what's driving, at least in part, the housing market and driving that quandary that's facing the RBA right now, because that cohort, while they're driving asset price inflation, they're not really sensitive to where interest rates are.
Okay, so putting that all together, are you saying then that interest rates are maybe not having the same dampening effect on house prices as you would in a regular economic cycle?
Yeah, I think that's certainly the case. I think, and I think this is the thing, we've been preaching patience for a long time to our investors. It's our word of the year for 2023 is patience. And I think it's just going to take time, because if you think about the overall mortgage market, we've got a third of people renting, a third of people with a mortgage, and a third of people without. Let's just call it sort of round numbers. And so there are a third of people who are starting to feel the impact of those rate hikes, but there's a third who aren't. And so it's just that balance between the two. Over time, I think the impact and the pressure on the people with mortgages is going to start to weigh on the overall housing market. But clearly, that hasn't been the case today.
Pete Robinson, it's always good to chat to you. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks, Hans.
And thank you for joining us. Don't forget to check out the rest of the income series, now available at livewiremarkets.com. Thanks for joining us.